great friends. I'm Carol. I'm from Big Square Books. Big Square Books and Savoy are independent booksellers that are in Mystic and Westerly. So if you haven't been into the store in a while, now's a great time. As you can see, we're getting tons of new books, and we have lots of great authors. We'd really like to thank Mohegan Sun for being an ongoing partner who helps us bring wonderful authors like the ones we have tonight to this beautiful space. We have a fantastic panel of historical fiction authors for you tonight. Unfortunately, Marie Benedict had a family emergency, so she will not be with us, but we still have a killer lineup of three fantastic authors with brand new books to share with you. First, I want to introduce to you Chris Bolak and Emily Fine. They are known as the Book Cougars. How many of you have listened to the Book Cougars podcast before? Okay, a bunch of you. They're awesome. they're a literary podcasting duo based in Guilford, Connecticut, who became what we consider the best kind of friends, reader friends. So if you need a reader friend, look around you, you might make one tonight. Together, Chris and Emily started an ongoing discussion about their favorite books and literary adventures, and you can find them on their bi-weekly podcasts. They're available from iTunes, Stitcher, or at bookcougars.com. So please help me give a warm welcome to the Book Cougars.
First is Fiona Davis. Fiona was born in Canada to English parents who eventually immigrated to the U.S. She grew up in New Jersey, Utah, and Texas. Fiona started her working life in the performing arts in New York City. And that is where each of her three novels are rooted, firmly in some of the historic buildings of the city. Her first novel was The Dollhouse. It featured the Barbizon Hotel for Women, and that book explored the 1950s to contemporary times. Her second novel was The Address, which centers on the Dakota Building, and that story went back and forth between the late 19th century, when the building was built, and the 1980s. And her latest novel, The Masterpiece, gorgeous cover, Grand Central Station, is the focus of that novel. And that goes back in time between two women, one from 1928, just before the crash, and 1974, when there were other economic difficulties. And Grand Central is a changing point for both of their lives. So welcome, Fiona.
Melodie Winawer, who is the author of Scribe of Siena, is a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania School of Medicine. She works as a neurologist at the Columbia University Medical Center, where her research focuses on the genetics of epilepsy. Now we know why she was able to draw so vividly the life of the main protagonist, neurosurgeon Dr. Beatrice Trovato, in her novel. In its review of the book, Psychology Today notes, Winawer has the smarts to write a novel that is imaginatively fictional, yet well-grounded in research. If you wonder how this physician and mother of three children wrote the novel, it was in large part during her 3-hour daily commute on the New York City subway. For any of you who've ridden the subway, Chris and I have done it many times to book events, you know what an amazing feat that must have been. Melodie is fluent in Spanish and French, literate in Latin, and can get by with her Italian, which I'm sure came in handy while writing the book. And we're very much looking forward to conversing with her in English this evening.
And last but not least is James Benn. James's first career was in library science and information technology. He started writing at the age of 50. In addition to his best-selling Billy Boyle World War II mystery series, James has also written two standalone novels, On Desperate Ground and Souvenir. Billy Boyle is an Irish-American cop from Boston who ends up helping his uncle, Ike Eisenhower, investigate sensitive military situations that take him throughout the European theater during World War II. And this, South Braves, is number 13 in the Billy Boyle series. So welcome, James.
I realize I didn't show the beautiful cover of Scribe of Sienna. So we're going to start with a group question for all of you. And when I read this, this is part of the author's note in Scribe of Sienna. I thought, this is so well written. So it says, but research, though it provided the necessary scaffolding for the story, wasn't enough. Because this isn't history, it's fiction. And fiction, by definition, goes between and beyond the facts. That is the privilege and the heavy pleasure of the novelist. So if each of you could take a minute to just describe your books so people know a little bit about what they're about, and then explain to us the process of how you researched what you were writing about and where you decided to put in fact and where you inserted fiction.
I'll go first. So I wrote The Masterpiece, and you know, for me, I do a lot of research first to figure out what the time period and the structure of the book will be. And so for Grand Central, I took this amazing tour of the building. I interviewed architectural historians and restoration contractors. I went to Avery Library at Columbia University, and I poured through boxes of black and white photos from when it first opened in 1913. It was just gleaming. It was gorgeous. And looked at floor plans. And so for me, that is the scaffold. That is the framework and the structure that I build the story around. And typically, I make up the characters from there, from something that catches my eye. For example, in the second book, The Address, it takes place at the Dakota apartment house. And there's a character who takes on the job of the lady manageress at the building in the 1880s. And I found that in a reference to the building in the 1930s, that there was a lady manageress. And I just loved that word, that phrase so much that I pulled it back into the 1880s and gave that as my character's job. So it was really taking a mix of facts that inspired me and then layering them into the story and seeing where it goes from there.
So, of course, I didn't think anyone actually read author's notes. That was a hugely satisfying moment for me. Plus, you read my acknowledgments. That's how you know I wrote it on the subway. I'm writing my second book very much on the subway, but I have learned to write at home, which is a great victory. So my book, The Scribe of Sienna, is about Beatrice Trovato, an Italian-American New York neurosurgeon with no time. I know that very well. Who inherits from her brother, who was a medievalist, not only his house in Siena, but also his research into a mystery of why Siena fared so badly during the plague. And Beatrice takes a leave of absence, and in her exploration of his work, she becomes more and more obsessed with the past, and also finds a journal by a 14th century painter in whose work she finds her own face. The lines between past and present are blurred, and she finds herself in the middle of the mystery that her brother was investigating about Siena's downfall during the plague as it approaches, and also the deadly conspiracy that he had begun to uncover that is over 700 years old. In doing so, the book ends up being actually a love affair with the past, as well as, for me, one of the things I'm really interested in historical fiction is how the past and history are not as far away as we think they are, but right here, close enough to touch, and that's something that I think I believe very strongly and motivated me to write that book. And there you again, which is very satisfying. So I'm a scientist as well as a doctor, and my research takes a sort of a similar path that it does in science, which is that when I'm reading, I find a question that I don't know the answer to. And first I think, well, am I just stupid and ill-informed, and therefore I need to find the answer easily from someone who knows it. I'll read some, don't find it. Ask experts around me, don't find it. Read more, still don't find it, or even better, find that it's controversial or that there are multiple answers. And at that point, when I get this experience of unanswered questions, I say, that's my next research project. And that's what happened with the Scribe of Siena. I found an unanswered question about Siena's downfall during the plague of 1348. And I decided, because there was no good answer, to make one up. Now, if I did that in my medical or scientific life, I would lose my job or kill people, which obviously I have no intention of doing. And so for me, and this is one of the reasons it's such a pleasure to write fiction, that invention is an incredible, exhilarating experience, because I cannot do anything like that in my day job. And so what I like to do in a similar way is to find facts that allow me to create a real place and time, and then find the spaces between the facts into which I can invent the story. In that book, none of the characters are real. In the book I'm writing now, a few of them are, which is an interesting challenge. But I think in the same way that Fiona mentioned, sometimes a tiny fragment is what inspires a whole rollout of fictional excitement. For example, you know, I was reading an incredibly horrendously dry monograph that I thought would never be useful to me, but I was forcing myself to read it. It described every ounce of dirt in an archaeological dig that was excavated in a place that wasn't even where I was writing a book about. And discovered that in this Byzantine civilization that is parallel to what I'm writing about now, a bones of a fetus were found buried in the earthen floor of the hearth of what would have been the kitchen. That created so much complex fictional explosion in my head. You know, even though it's one sentence buried in, you know, a 45-page examination of all of the dirt in this dig site. So you never know when you're going to find it, and it's not always obvious what's going to trigger that reaction.
My Billy Boyle series is it's linear in that it's set during the Second World War and follows the course of a military investigator who begins his work in 1942 at the beginning of American involvement in the war. So I have sort of a track laid out and working through the years of American involvement. So I don't have a lot of choice in what I want to write about, given that I have to maintain some continuity with the actual conflict. So what I try to do is find some really little known fact about the war, about our involvement, about what the impact was on participants, and illuminate that through the creation of an artificial crime, a murder that my character, Billy Boyle, has to investigate. It helps that he works for General Eisenhower, because then he can send him anywhere I want him to go. This current book, Solemn Graves, is set in France a few weeks after D-Day, and I knew I had to set one of the books during the D-Day experience, and I began casting around for what would be the idea, what's going to be the theme of this book. And what emerged was, at first, a realization that month to 6 weeks after D-Day was a really slow, horrible slog through Normandy, and a lot of the French exuberance about being liberated faded very quickly as their villages and farms became a battleground that the forces went back and forth over. And as I began to read more and more about that, I came across a great nonfiction book, La Parisienne by Anne Seba, who talks about the role of women during the occupation of France and the liberation. And she gave me a whole new way of looking at what happened to women during that period, because there were a lot of French women in the resistance as the Germans left and the Allies rolled in, and all of a sudden, many people were in the resistance. And a lot of them were men who had not done much and had felt emasculated by the occupation and took it out on a lot of women. So a lot of, it turns out a lot of those pictures that you see of women getting their heads shaved as collaborators were in fact just victims of male violence. A lot of them were prostitutes who did nothing different than a shopkeeper who took money for his goods and sold wine or bread to German soldiers. And that just opened up a whole new way of looking at that period for me. That's when I decided that was going to be the theme of this book. So I have a murderer, and then my guy's a detective, he's got to investigate it. But as he does, he goes through the Normandy countryside and meets a lot of this activity. The French called it the Wild Purge, which was fascinating to learn. Because there was a lawless period as towns were liberated before civil authority was brought in. It was like the Wild West. Over 10,000 people were murdered by other Frenchmen during the Wild Purge. 20,000 women had their heads shaved, some were tarred and feathered. There was no law at all. And, so that's sort of what you're talking about finding that gem of a hidden secret, because this was all whitewashed after the war. Nobody wanted to talk about it. So that's the kind of place I try to find. And when I can do that within the continuity of the story, that's heaven.
So one of the things that I was fascinated about when Chris and I, we were preparing for this, we were talking about how with historical fiction, it's really important to build, how did you describe it, Chris?
World building.
The world building, yeah, right. Yeah. And so for Fiona and Melodie, you had to build two worlds. You made your life a lot harder. So can you describe, I was curious just a little bit about how you worked that out in your own mind, and then did you write that literally, or did you, you know, handle each of the worlds separately when you would sit down to write?
Yeah, so one of the worlds is the 1920s, and as I was doing research, I learned that the painter John Singer Sargent, in the 1920s, he co-founded an art school at Grand Central Terminal. It was called the Grand Central School of Art. It was there for 20 years. It had 900 students a year. And no one had heard of it.
I haven't. Yeah. I had to look it up. I was like, is this the fiction part?
Yeah, that's the real part. And so that was fascinating because that brought me into this world of art and artists, and two of the main characters in that section are inspired by actual faculty members who were at the Grand Central School of Art in the 20s, who were these real pioneers who had really been lost to history. And so for me, I jumped into that part first and really figured out that world. And it's a female illustrator and a male abstract expressionist who are trying to make it in an art world in a city at a time that things were really in flux between kind of the heady days of the Roaring Twenties and then the oncoming depths of the Depression. And the two of them are very strong-willed characters, and they really butt heads. And so the story is about their fight to become good at what they do and successful at what they do. The other part of the book takes place in the 1970s, and that's from the point of view of a character named Virginia, who is kind of a down-on-her-luck ex-socialite, who's been through a divorce, and she has a surly teenage daughter, and she has to take a job as a clerk in the info booth in the middle of Grand Central. And to her, that is the ultimate in humiliation. And so, on her first day in the job, she stumbles into this abandoned art school and discovers a painting. And she wants to know, is it valuable? Who painted it? And as she starts looking into that and the provenance of this work of art, is it a masterpiece or not? She also gets caught up in the larger struggle to save Grand Central, which at that point was threatened by developers. They wanted to revoke the landmark status and kind of plot this 55-story skyscraper right on top. And they went to court in 74 to get the landmark status revoked, and they won. And so as my character starts looking into that fight to save the building, which in real life was led by Jackie O, she kind of opens her eyes up to the bigger picture and stops looking at her life so closely. And so that, you know, the question in the book is, this painting a masterpiece or not? Is the terminal a masterpiece or not? Should it be saved? And so for me, what I did is I really researched the 1920s part first, then researched the 70s, which was fun because, you know, the outfits are so great, and I kind of remember it. That makes it easier. And really made a lot of trips to the terminal and to figure out how to work it. And I set up an outline. I know where I'm going with each storyline, and then I weave them together using colored post-its. It's very high tech. And then I create a synopsis from that, and I use a program called Scrivener to actually write it, which makes the research a lot easier to just have at your fingertips. But I plot it all out. I figure out what each storyline needs to be, and because there's an element of mystery, I need to be careful as to when I, you know, drop a clue or a red herring, that it doesn't screw up the other timeline. And there are days I just want to go and eat a lot of cheese.
It's too hard. It's always a good solution for everything.
But I really try to plot it out and work from there to write it.
And did you ever get to actually see the school? Were you able to visit the school?
You know, I got so many places in the terminal, but not the school. It's up on the very seventh, it's the very top floor, the seventh floor of the East Wing, and now it's a training center for employees, and you need a special key to get in the elevator. I tried. But it's almost better, because I imagine this abandoned art school in the book, and I think it's almost better to not know that it's cubicles.
So I had an interesting task, because my book takes place in the 14th century, and our images of the 14th century come pretty much as, you know, they come from paintings mostly, and a lot of them are religious paintings, but sometimes there'll be details you can catch. And there are writings, people did write about the time, but it's not like they were describing things for you so that you would know what they looked like. So finding information to populate the time is actually challenging, not just the physical aspects of the time, but I mean, I think that reading firsthand accounts written by people in that time, including letters, which I did, and trial records, which I did, gives you a feeling for how people are thinking, which is almost more important. And I was thinking actually about your book, which is one of the most lovely things, is that it's one thing to just describe the place and what people are wearing and what people are eating, but it's another to get inside the consciousness of the time. And that is very delicate and beautiful. It's something well, I just read her book, it's super terrific. Not this one actually, but the one about Dakota. So getting the idea of the medieval consciousness, not the stereotyped version of the medieval world, but the internal beauty of that experience was really an interesting challenge for me. And I wanted, in some ways, kind of the psychological heart of the book was my protagonist's love affair with that consciousness, not just the structure of her plot, which is complicated and multi-timeline, but her beginning to understand what it means to be in that time, personally, what is beautiful about it, as well as what is challenging, and not the stereotype what you don't have version, but actually the what you do have version. And I was entranced myself with that time growing up, and so that was a deep return for me. I kind of wanted to go there myself. So, ways in which, you know, I think each of us finds different things that we connect to that bridge the past, bridge the past and the present. For me, one that was very, very big was food. I think food is really visceral. I mean, I'm a neurologist, right? I'm a neuroscientist, so this means I think about sometimes the way in which different sensory experiences wake different parts of us up. So, eating and taste and smell are really ancient parts of the brain, and they're connected to memory. And so I felt like if I could recreate the food of that time and eat it and know what it was like to cook it, then it would be my window and that I could walk into. And I did this a lot. I created multiple meals based on historic recipes. I actually collaborated with the author of cookbooks several times. I have thrown these insane parties that in which I once forced my guests to dress. They actually liked it. I was a little embarrassed, but I was encouraged to do it, and it was a 7-hour party. I played medieval music. I actually learned some because I played the cello. It didn't exist then, but close enough. You know, and I cooked for 3 days. I made almond milk from scratch, which I've now done 10 times. I recommend it highly. It's not like the stuff in the box at all. You know, I squeezed grapes with my hands. I did use, you know, an oven and running water, which was shortcuts that were necessary. But I really felt like through the food of medieval Italy, which is extraordinarily unlike turkey legs and beer, neither of which they had. You know, I had a deep psychological immersion in the past, and that comes through in the book. So that was one entry point for me. The thing about Siena, right, anybody been there? Okay, so the thing about Siena is that it is a city that exists in the past. And so it was easy to walk straight into medieval life from the present there. And that was, you know, one of the ways in which I connected the two, just because it actually has a living medieval existence.
Oh, you don't have to do
No, James, you know, the U.S. involvement in World War II, it was just a few years, really, and you're working on your 14th Billy Boyle story now, and I know you mentioned pacing things out a little bit in the series. So we were just wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you do that, and what you choose to put in and not put in. I know one of your books was a little controversial for one of the issues that you explored, the segregation in the army. And in this book, I felt like I learned a lot about the French resistance and all the different units, and obviously the ill treatment of women. So I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that and how you decide and if Billy will ever make it to the Pacific War Theater.
Yeah, what the A Blind Goddess was one of the previous books, and that did deal with segregation in the U.S. Army. And the Army practiced Southern-style 1930s segregation when they were trying to fight a war in Europe. And it was the only book that I've actually received hate mail over. It all was along the lines of, why are you rubbing our noses in this stuff with the blacks? You know, haven't we heard enough about how the blacks were treated? And I was shocked because these all came from people who had been following the series and had no trouble reading about genocide against the Jews or anything else, and all of a sudden they didn't like hearing about what it was really like for blacks and whites who had to coexist separate and not equal in England, maybe as they're waiting for D-Day to happen. And in that book, to introduce that, I took a true event and I had the characters meet at a pub in the first chapter. And the idea behind this book was a friend of Billy's, a black kid from Boston, had contacted him and needed his help. And they arranged to meet at a pub. And it was in a town that had been designated as a leave center for black troops only. But then more white troops came into that area, so the blacks were given a smaller, more distant town where they could take their leave, because the army never let blacks and whites have leave together in the same town. So the unit that was coming into this town was 101st Airborne, the Band of Brothers. And what happened in real life, and this is the setting for the first chapter, is that the last day that it was a black leave center, truckloads of guys from the 101st came in to town with baseball bats and went into every pub and smashed every glass so they would not have to train up in the same classes as black soldiers. So I have them meet and their feet are crunching under broken glass, and it was just a way into that, because it's so, for as many problems as we have now, it was still such an alien concept that people would take things that far. So getting into the mindset of the 1930s and the 1940s it's a challenge, because those were really different people. They're the same in some ways and very different in other ways in terms of what they know, what they expect, what their experience of the world is, because it was very minimal. If you were a young man of the 1930s, you never went anywhere essentially. You stayed in your town or your county or on your farm. And all of a sudden they're thrown into this environment where they have to interact with people from other classes and other races. So it's finding that, it's a trick in a sense, finding that trick to get the reader instantly in that point of view. And sometimes you just can't be super realistic. If I was very realistic, the N-word would have been in every other sentence. Fuck would have been in every sentence in every book, because those guys, just that's how they talk all the time. So you have to make it accessible for readers, but keep it realistic to the experience, which is a bit of a balancing act. So I don't know if that answers the question, that's just a challenge.
And the Pacific War Theater? Any chance of Billy Boyle making it to the Pacific War Theater? Or is he going to stay?
I don't need to go on this one.
Well, we didn't get the 5-minute warning mark, but we would like to end with another joint question, if you all don't mind. And this is coming from Fiona's book. This is a couple sentences that one of the characters says. It's Clara, and she's, in her 70s probably at this point. "Look at me. No one knows what I am, but I don't care, because I love the way I move in the world. I love my perspective of the world. I've earned it, and anyone else can go to hell." So we're wondering, if you can all say a minute or two of how writing historical fiction has changed your perspective of the world and or your life.
Yeah, you know what's interesting is before this we were all talking and we realized we all wrote our first book around the age of 50. Which I think gives you an interesting perspective because you've been through things and you've, had other careers. And so for me, I found that writing historical fiction taps into my absolute love of doing research and history and discovering how women's voices and agency have changed over time. You know, what was it like to be a married woman in the 50s? What was it like to be single in the 1880s and pregnant? And so to dive into that and explore how the world has changed and in ways it hasn't, to me is really what gets me going. And on top of that, I think that's the perspective of age. I often have one character who's younger and one who's older. And neither of them are perfect. And neither of them are right all the time. And they learn from each other. And for me, it's especially having older characters, I find that's how you really bring women's voices to life, because I think they're often ignored. And they tend to be feisty in my books.
There are so many layers to this question, I'm kind of lost in the maze of it right now, sorry, drifting, but I think it gets back to something that I'm particularly fascinated with, which is the way that the past and the present intersect. And I think they do all the time, not just because you read a history book and therefore learn something, but because the past is living. All the pasts are living now in some way. And we have, in some way, access to them. And I think, maybe this comes from my perspective as a neuroscientist also, but when you write and when you read, there is a process of empathy, which is much written about now, both in positive and negative ways. But you get inside another world, you get inside another life, and you, if it's fiction in particular, and this has actually been studied, it's more so with fiction than with nonfiction, you are transformed by that experience, and there is that transformation changes who you are in your way of looking at other people forever, probably, as well as yourself. And so that's true when you read. It's also, I think, very, very deeply true when you write. And so it is both exhausting and extraordinary to inhabit another person, a person of your own creation. It's particularly unbelievable. And a person of your own creation who, at the moment, one of my characters, lived 800 years ago in sort of southern Peloponnesus in Greece. So that experience, I was thinking of, what are the little pieces of fact that change you? Right now, I'm very preoccupied because I learned a word that turned into an entire universe, which is gasmol, which was the French word used to describe the mixed breeds, the children of occupation, because Greece was occupied multiple times for centuries and centuries and centuries, and its current life is very much influenced by that experience of recurrent occupation. So I became very, very preoccupied with understanding what it meant to be, the child of occupation, to have a soldier of the occupying nation be your father, and a woman of the occupied nation be your mother, and how that imprinted itself upon you so that you really embodied your land and its dual, complex threads. And particularly actually a peaceful occupation, which is even harder, because you're not exactly sure whether you're being taken or whether you're being mixed or what it is. And so, I spent a lot of time thinking about something that I think Americans don't think about very much, which is what it means to have another country come and take you over and run you for a while. So that has, I think, been an effort of transformation for me to understand that perspective, to understand what it means to be a country that keeps being inhabited by other people. The native people of this country probably have that experience. We're standing here on reservation land, so we're sitting. So, I think there are people in this country who have that experience of recurrent occupation, not all of us. So that's really been a big exploration. And I also think that for me, this empathy has this question of how empathy helps us understand the past is not a dry academic exercise, because those walls that divide us from what we think is so different are the same walls that we are struggling with now that make others so frightening. And I feel like those are the lessons about the way we connect to people who lived 600 years ago or in the 1940s or in another country are the same lessons that we have to learn about that currently are perpetuating violence in our world. And they're personal lessons, they're not just global lessons. I have to learn them too. So.
It's an odd connection between working as a writer and sitting alone and having all these people in your head, and then going out. I just came back from a bookstore visit, and people came with artifacts from the war, and they wanted to show me the postcard that their great uncle had sent back from Europe. Or one woman came, she had a necklace with a gold coin on it, and it was from her grandfather, who was of the paratroopers, who, when they dropped into North Africa, they were given gold coins, so if they drifted off course, they could pay a Bedouin to take them into the lines. And they were supposed to give them back, and her grandfather kept one. And so she still had it, and it was next to her heart. The things we write about that are part make-believe, part real, are 100% real to readers who enter that world willingly and want to be part of it. And I just saw that in the things that people brought with them to show and to validate their own experience and to make a connection with this book and the characters that I've just created on the whole cloth. And that is sort of a transformative experience to have that come full circle from a blank page with nothing to people making that human connection with you over their lives and the lives of your characters.
Great, thank you all so much. Do we have time for a couple of questions? If anyone in the audience has a question.
There are microphones out there.
On there.
Don't be shy.
Okay.
I think Melodie sort of alluded to this already in her last response, but I was wondering for Fiona and James, in your current book, is there something about the direct lesson for current times that's maybe a little more subtle in the book, but that you're hoping readers will take away?
You know, actually, the only answer I draw is that things don't change. There's so much, I'm struck constantly by things that I thought were past due or come back to haunt us. I mean, just look at today, the treatment of women, and I'm writing a book about women being erased from history and abused, and their place in history taken over by men. Come on.
Yeah, you know, for me, I'm writing about this woman artist who's really struggling to make her mark, and it was incredible reading all these biographies of women artists from the 1920s, and how they were just, you know, second-class citizens. One changed her name to a man's name in order to get her work exhibited. And so, yeah, I think for me, that's very similar. I'm very interested in, for example, in this book, they talk in the 1970s about, well, you know, the Equal Rights Amendment is due to pass. Of course it will. And of course we know it didn't. And so just jumping back in history and seeing how far we have to go. And yes, like today, it's pretty depressing. But we'll get there.
It's one of the interesting things about reading historical fiction, because you do know some of the truths as you're reading, right? I mean, the plague was kind of a thriller aspect of your book, you know, and you know what's about to happen, but the people in the book don't know what's about to happen, so it's a really interesting.
Except that one of them sort of does, which
yes.
Is, I mean, this is the fun about having a dual timeline story, and there are sort of more fundamentally realistic ways of doing it, and ones that take a little bit of a departure from realism in order to accomplish that. And I think we're kind of, we overlap, but I'm a little bit farther over in this direction. But that's one of the things I think is fun about juxtaposing the past and the present in one book, is that you can play with the knowledge of the present while looking at the past. And that reflection, I find myself, when I'm writing in just one time, I get sort of irritable. I feel stuck. You know, but if I can move through time, then there are things I can do that are more fun. And I can learn from them as my protagonist fumbles through, not knowing the past, that while the people that she's with don't know the future.
Another question out there?
Melodie, I'm anticipating your next book. Can you give us a little flavor on what you're writing and kind of whet our appetite a little bit?
Yeah, so I'm so excited, actually, because it was even announced. It's coming. I'm working fast as I can. It's called The Anticipation, amusingly enough, for reasons that you won't find out until you read it. And it's about Mistras, which is a city that is now in ruins, in the southern Peloponnesus, which is a peninsula in the southernmost part of Greece. Nobody knows about Mistras. It's extraordinary, actually, because it's a World Heritage UNESCO site, and it was the capital of the Byzantine Empire, which is the longest running empire in the history of the world. How many people knew that? I didn't know that before I started writing this book. Wow, okay, you're impressive. Better woman than I, clearly, but 1,100 years of continuous government and laws, and they consider themselves the inheritors of the Roman Empire. This is from 300 until 1400, one empire. And it's almost never talked about in, you know, modern American society, certainly. So Mistras was the capital after the fall of Constantinople. It's an incredible place that I visited. You can still walk through it, this city that probably held up to 40,000 people at one point. And was a center for all sorts of amazing intellectual and cultural things. Of course, it's not just about a place. You can't just write about a place. It's about people. And I wanted to tell the story of the end of that empire, of the sort of tragic final years. But I want to tell it with the knowledge that modern Greece is its legacy. And when I was in the time of the referendum, which is when we, you know, decided whether or not it wanted, sort of, was given the opportunity to decide in a way that didn't really play out, whether to be part of the European Union or not. I don't know whether you know this, I didn't then, I do now, that Greece decided, everybody was allowed to decide what was on the back of the euro for their country, and Greece put the Rape of Europa on the back by Zeus. Just FYI, this is an extraordinary illustration of, you know, Greece being felt, feeling put upon for centuries, and not really part of the West, and not ever really welcomed as part of the West. So I'm having a very Greek sensibility right now, not being Greek at all. This is the empathy that happens when you write a book, is you fall in love with the place that you're inside. So this is the story. It is dual timeline, but the back timeline moves, so there's a lot of challenge. And it definitely is a person in the present, and a person in the past, and their lives are intersecting with increasing intensity over time. It's not the same kind of playing with time that I did in this book, but I feel the necessity of doing something. I can't help myself. So I hope that's a little taste. I'm quite excited by it. It's a really lot of fun to write.
All right, one more question?
I'm sorry, was the question about Sirius?
Yes.
And do you have a desire, James, to write another standalone?
I have written some standalone books, and they are, I write in the first person in my Sirius, so the big pleasure for me is when I write a standalone, it's the third person, and because I can just kind of relax and spread out and have the story go where it wants to go, because writing in the first person is, you're just seeing the whole thing through one set of eyes, which is great to have to communicate a voice, but it has certain restrictions. So it's fun to do it in different ways.
The first book, which is at the Barbizon Hotel for Women, there's so many opportunities because so many famous people live there. I've had a lot of people ask, would you do another one that's, you know, based around the hotel and continue on the story. But for me, each book really revolves around a building. And so I feel like there's a lot of New York buildings left to explore. I figure by my 30th book, I'll be doing the gas station on 9th Avenue.
What's the next building?
The next building is the Chelsea Hotel. And it's in the 1950s, and it's from the point of view of an actress and a playwright who lived there, two women. And it's during the McCarthy era. So it's been a lot of fun to research and write.
So when I was writing my first novel, which you see on the table, when I finished it, the first of 750 times, I called a friend of mine who had been intimately involved in reading it early on, and a fan, and I said, I finished a draft of my novel, and he said, go out and celebrate. And I said, celebrate? I'm falling apart with despair. It was just a horrible experience to think I was done, which of course I was not at all. And every time I go back to it, I'm happy, although now I'm happy to be doing something else. But so for a while, the thought of leaving those characters in that place, that had taken me so long to understand it well enough to generate it without looking stuff up, to not just the history, but I began to understand the people well enough to know how they would operate if something happened to them, rather than having to figure that out from scratch. And it takes quite a while to get to that point. In fact, my agent asked me to add a section of a reaction to a terrible thing that happened in my character. And she said, I know you haven't written it yet, but can you just sit down and do it? And I just got inside her and did that. And it was so extraordinary to be back. And so initially I thought, God, I really don't want to leave them. And then I realized that I absolutely had to. As a writer, I needed to go somewhere else. I needed needed to be with other people. And I needed to start again, and I needed to know that I could. You know, in a lot of ways, a sequel is a very, very natural thing for this book, and in some, and the story I had intended to tell goes to 1355 from a historical perspective, and I know how that story goes, and I have even pieces of it written, but I just didn't want to tell that story next. I didn't want to have serialized that story. I wanted to tell a different story, and actually the third story I have in mind after this one takes me to yet another place, which is, you know, why am I challenging myself like this? It's really exhausting, you know, the creep. But in any case, you know, I feel like that challenge is part of what keeps me going, and I love the novelty of it. And maybe someday I would write that sequel because it's in there, actually. But I wanted to travel.
Well, I just read a sequel that was written 17 years later, so, you know, you have plenty of time. So I guess we have to wrap it up.
Yeah,
we would love to talk to you guys.
We would love to see you, I think, quite easily. There is going to be an author signing, and that will be in the concourse. I think if you walk out and head left, follow the people, I think is the way to go, and you can have your book signed.
And don't forget, signed books are really nice gifts also.
Yeah, it's never too early to start thinking about the holidays.
I wasn't going to say the H word, Chris, but yeah, it's coming. It's around the corner, as they say. So
thank you all for coming tonight. We'd like to thank Mohegan Sun again and Benn Square Books. And if we can get a round of applause for all of our audience.
Oh, right.